It's a pleasant good afternoon to you all. So on behalf of Civil Engineering Department, Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering, so I'm very much happy to welcome the speaker of the afternoon session, so such an eminent expert, Professor C.V.R. Murthy, Professor Civil Engineering of IIT Madras, to deliver the lecture on overview of Indian earthquake design codes. So I'm very much happy to introduce Professor C.V.R. Murthy to the audience. So he's presently Professor Civil Engineering of IIT Madras, and also he is the Institute Chair Professor from 2017 to 2022 at IIT Madras. And regarding his educational background, Professor C.V.R. Murthy has completed his B.Tech Civil Engineering in the year 1984 and M.Tech Civil Engineering in the year 1986 from IIT Madras. He has completed his PhD in the year 1992 from California Institute of Technology, USA. His specialization is structural earthquake engineering, and the research interest of Professor C.V.R. Murthy is in the area of nonlinear behavior of steel and reinforced concrete buildings and reinforced concrete bridges. Professor C.V.R. Murthy has undertaken post-earthquake surveys to document valuable lessons after all the significant Indian earthquakes in the last few years. He was the team leader for a unique WERI reconstruction reconnaissance survey undertaken after the massive reconstruction operations after the 2001 Bhuj earthquake. Professor C.V.R. Murthy has contributed to significant revisions of Indian seismic codes for buildings and bridges. He has conducted very successful continuing education programs on seismic design in India, Nepal, and Bhutan. He has participated in two successful technical collaborations with CBRI Roorkee, India, and Tribhuvan University, Nepal. Professor Murthy is the author of very popular IITK BMTPC Earthquake Tips, a public education series on learning earthquake-resistant design and construction, published regularly in leading national newspapers and journals. The book has received the Best Construction Technique Award from the Indian Concrete Institute in the year 2005. Professor Murthy is the principal author of the National Disaster Management Policy and Guidelines for Earthquakes, a policy document by the National Disaster Management Authority, Government of India. So this is the primary policy document identifying comprehensive action plan items to be undertaken towards seismic safety in India. To his credit, Professor C.V.R. Murthy has received many awards and honors. To list a few, he is the chairman of Earthquake Engineering Sectional Committee, CED 39, from 2020 onwards, the Bureau of Indian Standards, Government of India. And also, he has received the ICA Best Paper Award in the year 2018 for the best paper published in ICA Journal, Limiting Twisting During Earthquakes in Buildings with Unsymmetrical Stiffness in Plan Elastic Study. And also, he has received the ICI Best Paper Award in the 2016 also for the best paper published in the ICA Journal. The title of the paper is Importance of Plinth Beams in Mitigating Negative Effects of Flexible Column Bases in Seismic Behavior of RC Moment Frame Buildings. And also, he has received Best Teacher Award in IIT Hyderabad in the year 2009, Distinguished Teacher Award IIT Kanpur in the year 2008. And also, he is the Fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering, Fellow of Institution of Engineers, and he's the Editor-in-Chief for the World Housing Encyclopedia. And also he has received, he's the Honorary Advisor for Delhi State Disaster Management Authority, Government of NCT of Delhi 2005. And to his credit, he has published about 87 Scopus Index journals, and also he's guiding many MS and PhD scholars. So we are very fortunate to have Professor C.V.R. Murthy today to deliver the lecture on overview of Indian earthquake design codes. So thank you so much, Professor, for accepting our invitation to share your expertise in this particular theme. So welcome you, Professor, for this program. So I over to Professor C.V.R. Murthy.
Thank you, madam, for your kind words. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to come and share a thought with you this afternoon on the subject of earthquake safety. And I would like to thank Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering for giving me this opportunity. I am particularly grateful to Madam Professor Kumuda for this warm affection and invitation to be part of this training program. So the subject, as she said, is about earthquake design codes. I'll present the philosophy, the evolution of standards, and the future of standards in the country. So I must begin traditionally by saying that earthquakes are a sudden and a rapid movement under the buildings, and they are not forces applied on the buildings. So clearly, it is an oscillation under the building, unlike wind, which is a pressure applied on the building. And this subject on the left-hand side is not taught in any college as part of the undergraduate education in the country. And hence, most of our users think that earthquake is a force. Earthquake is not a force. Force is induced because of the sudden time-dependent movement that happens under the building. Also, unlike wind, which is a non-zero mean force, earthquake shaking is a cyclic activity. And so it is much more severe than in the case of wind, because in a fraction of a second, the building has to reverse back and forth and undergo even damage. Talking about damage, under wind forces, which is a force applied on the structure, building should not undergo any damage. But under earthquake forces, we have a choice that we can permit some inelastic actions. And that is where the big difference is in wind design and in the earthquake resistant design. So let's come to the first segment of today's discussion. We are looking at ground oscillating. As a consequence, building oscillates. As a consequence, deformation is induced in the building. And that induced deformation also causes stresses to be induced in them. And hence, stress resultants, bending moment, shear forces, axial forces. All this is happening because there is inertia force that is induced where the mass is. And so typically in a building, it will be at the floor levels where most of the mass is concentrated. So one other important point to remember is we don't build earthquake-proof buildings. We build only earthquake-resistant buildings. That means for the known level of shaking, we are designing them to undergo or resist the shaking with damage. But if the shaking level is beyond what is given as the design earthquake shaking, there is no guarantee that we are able to ensure no collapse beyond that. So one important point that one needs to remember here is earthquakes. Minor earthquakes will cause a smaller amount of forces to be induced, and the structure is still linear. In moderate, the structure starts getting into nonlinear behavior, and under severe, it enters large nonlinear actions. And it is interesting that this earthquake resistant design philosophy will require that the structure is designed to resist the effects at all three levels. In particular, under the minor shaking, no structural damage is permitted. Under moderate shaking, some structural damage is permitted. And under severe shaking, structural damage will be there, but there should be no collapse. And this is the philosophy for normal buildings. To make this philosophy come true, for large number of years, for about four, five, six decades now, four virtues have been identified that earthquake resistant structure should have. First is configuration, second is stiffness, third is strength, and fourth is ductility. These are the four desirable features that it must have. But when you look at what has happened in the past in the country, and you review both monolithic and precast constructions, you realize that yes, somewhere we have not been following this understanding of the four virtues have not been provided in our buildings and structures. In the recent times, we've added some more challenges to ourselves, that is glass. And we are looking at large amount of false ceilings and so many other non-structural elements added to the structure. And hence, there is a lot more challenge that is happening in the design process. Of course, when you look at the standards, for a large number of years, our water tank code is highly deficient. And so both frame staging as well as in shaft staging structures, they have collapsed. Especially here, you may want to notice that the shaft staging structures have a single curtain of reinforcement That means the concrete on both sides of this reinforcement is a cover concrete. There is no structural concrete. And we have built a large number of these structures in the country without any structural concrete. And hence, these tend to become informal structures. They are not formally designed and built. All this is because there is an excitement to reduce cost, but the reduction of cost cannot be at the cost of safety of the structure and of the people in that area. Bridges also have been seen to have been designed inadequately in high seismic regions. And there are a number of improvements that have been made in the recent times, and those have come in handy and been validated by some of the earthquakes also. But still, there are over 1.5 lakh structures, 1,30,000 masonry bridges, and an equal and much larger number of concrete bridges that have been built across the country, just for the Indian Railways alone, not to talk about the Indian highways, which are requiring great help in terms of retrofit. And hence, there is a great opportunity, professional opportunity, for students, faculty members, and professionals to spend their time and attention on earthquake retrofitting of structures. When you look at industries, that's much bigger challenge, because as you can see, it's not a regular structure and it's not a repetitive structure. There are large number of large variety of structures in this, like building-like structures, stack-like structures, pipelines, cylinders, and a huge number of conveyor belts. Also, these dimensions are so large that when the earthquake happens, the rigidity of these some of these pipes will cause damage. Because displacement design is something that has not been addressed in most of the cases. Another important area that is growing and causing us more and more worry each day passing is the fact that we are now going to smear the whole country with long distance pipelines carrying fuel, water, and other important items. They typically are about a meter, meter and a half, or 2 meters in diameter. They can be above ground or below ground. Our main worry is when they cause the faults, are we able to allow the pipelines to swing back and forth and go through the slip that the fault will offer? If not, we have to design them more carefully than what we have done. If we don't do that, of course, this will be the scenario that we will face rather regularly across the country. Whenever there is a slip across a fault, we can be embarrassed. Alongside, there are over 3,500 dams in the country that need to be assessed. Based on the new knowledge that we have, new tools that we have, and hence there is an immense opportunity for us to do some good work. But all this can happen only if there is a guidance, and the guidance is always in the form of Indian standards. This is a summary slide that in a nuclear power plant, we have a whole spectrum of structures. Likewise, in a city, we have a whole spectrum of structures. In the country, we have a whole spectrum of structures. And we need a whole spectrum of standards also for that. But what is very interesting is that each of these structures, the expectation of their performance is different. And as you go towards the right, you get a little more serious, and the expectation is much, much higher in terms of performance. And therefore, we need people to concentrate on different types of structures and spend their career and a lifetime on that, rather than try to do everything. And therefore, I would urge younger persons who are listening today to consider picking a blue ocean strategy, means where there are very few people, and build your skills and competencies. And in the long run, you will be the one that India will require and ask for help to support the technological needs of the nation. Earthquake design is interesting. You can say, I will allow damage. On the same token, you can say, no, I don't want to allow any damage. So I'll design the structure to remain elastic. And so therefore, the choice is in the hands of the designer. But of course, the client will pay for the higher costs should the structure have to be remaining elastic during strong earthquake shaking. The second part that I want to spend some time on is evolution of standards. I mentioned that we have four virtues of earthquake resistant structures: configuration, stiffness, strength, and ductility. So in keeping with this, the standards have also grown alongside in that. The first thing that was practiced was that they observed that simple shapes are the best shapes. And simple here means the left hand side convex shapes and not the right hand side concave shapes. I pray that you know the difference between the two. In a convex shape, any two points inside the object, if you connect, the line joining them will remain inside the object. But in a concave, the line joining will not remain inside. And what is this line joining? Line joining is actually the flow of inertia forces from where the mass particles are to the foundation here. And therefore, this is an important requirement that we must follow. In the yesteryears, it was always made sure that the structures were simple in geometry, both in plan as well as in elevation. But in the recent times, we are taking chances and chances on somebody's life, and we are building structures on the right hand side. And it is known that these are not good forms, and still we continue to build those structural forms. We must at some point of time stop this habit of trying to do things just because they look a little more exciting. I do recognize that architecture is important, but without safety, architecture will lose value. And hence, we need to blend architecture and structural safety together and make structures that can be more aesthetically appealing as well as structurally safe. In fact, this is what one of the noted earthquake engineers said: if we have a poor configuration to start with, all the engineer can do is to provide band-aid, improve a basically poor solution as best as he can. Conversely, if we start off with a good configuration and a reasonable framing system, even a poor engineer cannot harm its ultimate performance too much. So it looks like the choice of the configuration will decide the safety of the structure. And so we need to be very, very careful in picking only the simple shapes so that we win 80% of the performance just by the choice of the configuration. And then if you choose a good structural engineer, it can go to 95%. But if you choose a poor configuration, 20% efficient, the best engineer can only add half to that and it will become 20.5%. So it's a big difference, and don't underestimate the importance of structural configuration. The second point, the second aspect in design is lateral stiffness. If the structure is very flexible, it will swing back and forth and damage, it will cause discomfort to the people living in that and damage all non-structural elements and also cause threat to the structural elements. And hence, minimum lateral stiffness, at least a minimum lateral stiffness is required in structures. But what is interesting is stiff structures are also massive structures. In fact, in yesteryears, they used to build only stiff structures. But en route, when you do stiff structures, when you buy stiffness, you will get mass free. And that is what has been noticed in many structures, that when you have very massive structures, the mass is very large. Acceleration is fixed, that is from nature. But if you multiply with larger mass, you'll get larger force. And larger force combined with brittle masonry material is not helping. And hence, it has been observed that dynasties have collapsed when earthquakes have happened. In 1962, the Indian standard started the journey that stiffness based is insufficient, and we would like to add at least a minimum strength to the buildings, and that is what is the essence of the Indian standards, the beginning of Indian standards. But having said that, even today we are not able to build simple cycle stands properly, and that is because earthquake resistant design is not part of the mandatory curriculum in any college in the country in 2021, almost 72-73 years after India's independence, we still have not given priority to life. The third aspect is strength, the third virtue that we are looking at in the development of standards. And the Indian standard has recognized that we need to bring in the concept of response reduction factor and the design force is obtained by considering the elastic behavior, doing linear structural analysis, and dividing the result of a linear structural analysis with the response reduction factor and getting the design force. And this is reflected in the lateral strength expression that VB is AH times W, where AH is the horizontal acceleration spectral value and W is the seismic weight. So what is the variation of AH with natural period? In 1920s, it was constant. It was a flat line, 0.1 W. In 1962, when we started our code, we started with a constant up to a certain value of natural period, and then it started dropping. In 1984, when we modified it, we brought in different soil classes and said soil also makes an important contribution. And so for rocks, it is lesser, but flexible soils will be larger. In 2002, the amplification was all brought to the same benchmark, and the expression was revised with response reduction factor coming into the picture. So this was the beginning of a strength-based design where lateral resistance or lateral force, design lateral force was specified. There was no strength hierarchy, and the design of members for shear was independent of the design of members for PM interaction. That is when the fourth virtue came into picture. In 2002, we said, no, we need to go forward a little more. And then we brought in the concept of ductility. And ductility is the maximum displacement or deformability of the structure to the yield deformability. And this happens only by hard work, by providing the detailing, reinforcement detailing, the way it is specified formally in the standard. If it is not done, then you will not be able to achieve. If you are lazy, not implementing 135 degree hooks at the ends of the bent bars, then of course the structure is as good as a brittle structure, and collapses will continue to happen in this country. So all of it depends on our intent. If we are intent, then we should be able to implement safety because of that. So many of us get confused between flexibility and ductility. And I want to emphasize that flexibility is not ductility. Here are different connections, strong axis connections. That means beam to column connection, let us say. And as you make the connection more and more robust, you are noticing that the relative deformation between beam and column is reducing. And this is not the issue that we are talking about in ductility. This is about flexibility of the connections and the relative deformation between the beam and the column. So please recognize flexibility is a stiffness matter and ductility is not a stiffness matter. It is a deformability matter. And deformability is how much it can swing back and forth with damage, the total lateral deformation, the maximum lateral deformation by the yield lateral deformation. So these soft, flexible, semi-rigid, rigid, these words are used only for stiffness matters and not for ductility matters, right? So in 2002, by bringing the response reduction factor into picture, the matter of ductility was highlighted, and it came in the denominator in the form of 2R, where 2R is the total reduction that we will do to bring the force from elastic level to the design level. So this was the beginning of capacity design, where we had beam to column strength ratios coming into picture, and the design of members for shear was dependent on the PM interaction. The next issue was overall deformability, the delta max in the structure. And this deformability has not been addressed in the standard yet. So this is work in progress. So we have not addressed deformability yet in our structures. Right. So how does deformation help is the key question. So if this is the structure that we have, and that's the backbone curve that we obtain, that's the delta capacity maximum that it can be pushed. If the earthquake is less than that, asking less than that displacement, then the building will be able to resist that earthquake. But if the earthquake is asking more than that, the building will collapse. And that is how serious and how important it is. So while in earthquake hazard assessment, we've always been talking about acceleration, and that is not sufficient. And we need to now talk about how much is the maximum displacement that the earthquake is imposing on the structure and whether the structure has that much of deformation capacity. And just to emphasize that same point once more, these are four buildings that have been designed for the same site with different levels of lateral force and the different yield values. And of course, they have different deformabilities. Maximum deformation capacities are different for each of them, right? The red one has the least and the blue one has the largest. So if there's an earthquake shaking up to this level, you can see the red one has gone into serious nonlinear behavior. The orange is just about getting into nonlinear action. Green and blue are not having nonlinearities. But if the earthquake rises to this level, the red building will collapse. Orange is almost on the brink of it. Green goes into nonlinear action. Blue is still linear. If the earthquake becomes a little more severe, orange building collapses. Green building is on the brink of collapse, and the blue is getting into large nonlinear actions. And of course, if the structure, if the site has an earthquake shaking beyond what is specified in the standard, then these also will collapse. If you read the MSK scale, it says at intensity 10, even designed engineered buildings of type C will collapse. Though that is the definition of this, that is the genesis of this pictogram, where we are looking at intensity 10 on MSK scale will say that even engineered buildings can collapse. So this is the basis, this is the humility of calling all the structures that we design as earthquake resistant and not earthquake proof, right? But at no point of time I was talking about the y-axis, because y-axis doesn't matter at all. So from today, I want all of you to move your heads to the x-axis from the y-axis, because y-axis is a consequence. We have designed four buildings with different force levels, and we got four buildings. But what is important is we got four buildings with different deformation capacities, and they could, the blue building could survive three earthquakes, but the fourth one was beyond it. But in the case of the red building, it could survive only one, orange only two, and so on. So what we realized is that if you are looking at a structure, overall deformability is very important. But today, we don't verify that when we do design. We don't verify this part at all in our design procedure. So we assume that when 2R is equal to 10 or R mu is equal to 5, we assume that the structure has a ductility of 5. But we never verify that. And that is our trouble, that our design process is incomplete as of now. We presume that we have provided all the ductility, but ductility is not quantified. We don't know how much ductility we have provided by the detailing that we have done. So is it low ductility, medium, or high ductility is unclear from this. Another important point that after the 2016 version of the standard came into picture, we realized that we also want to bring in a desirable collapse mechanism to be induced into the structure. And that is when a sentence was introduced in the standard saying mechanisms that result in ductile behavior are encouraged. But in time ahead, we hope that we will be able to guide a little more on how to ensure that such a mechanism can be developed. Now, as you see, there are large number of, depending on the degree of indeterminacy, kinematic indeterminacy, you will see that the large number of hinges will be required to be formed. But what is important is for the entire curve to happen and for us to go up to delta max, the first hinge that gets formed should continue to bend, rotate, and undergo inelastic actions till the last hinge is formed. And this is where most of the difficulty is. The current design procedure does not allow this to happen. And as a consequence, we have made the structures to undergo undesirable collapse mechanisms. The first one is open ground story building, which the whole country is crazy about. And we spend all our lifetime savings and buy apartments or homes in apartment buildings where they have open ground stories with only 9-inch columns provided. The second one is hotel buildings with tall lower stories with no infill walls. The third one is weak extensions made on existing buildings without connecting that extension to the existing building, just resting it on top. And the fourth one is where we have a hotel building in which we have removed all the infill walls and intermediate story just because we wanted glass to be put in there because it's a restaurant there. But what remains as our best friend is the good mechanism, and that is the only one, and that's only a single mechanism. All these other mechanisms are inappropriate, insufficient, and unsafe for us. So we need to choose the right hand side, a mechanism. We need to design the structure such that this mechanism is realized, and guarantee to ourselves before we sign the drawing that indeed this mechanism has been achieved. Otherwise, as you notice here, in most of the current designs, the lower part of the building alone participates, and the upper part is actually having a jolly ride without doing much work. This happens in typical schools and colleges where there are some set of students who don't do any work in a project or in a team activity, and they just take a ride along and then get their grades. But that doesn't help them. When they really go to the real world, it will hurt them. And that is exactly the scenario in building design also. And so this needs to be corrected urgently. So only one mechanism is possible needs to be encouraged, and we need to bring that desirable collapse mechanism. In effect, what is happening is we know our material, we design sections, we design our members, and we do detailing and go ahead and construct the structure. That's right. But we don't do the reverse process of ensuring that we have enough deformability and that the collapse mechanism is right. We're doing the forward loop, but not doing the reverse loop. And that is the reason why we will continue to see collapses in this country, because we are not closing the loop. Unlike in the case of wind and other force-based loads, where the force maximum is known and you can just design for that. In the case of earthquake, earthquake is displacement load, and there is no upper limit on that. Anything can happen. But even for the known deformation demand that is expected to be resisted by structure, we are not guaranteeing that our structure has that deformability. And therefore, we are at fault, and we need to correct that urgently. So this is called deformation-based design. It has not yet come into practice. It is still at a research level. And we hope that very soon this will come into practice in some form in our Indian standards. The next one, the seventh level, is energy. And let me explain the concept of energy. You see different earthquake ground motions here, and they have three characteristics. One is amplitude, second is duration, and third is frequency content, right? Duration, you can all understand that some earthquakes are very short duration, some are very large. Amplitude, you understand, is the vertical scale of this graph. And frequency content is something that you'll see in the first graph. In the first accelerogram, you are seeing that you have a nice wavy action in the ground, and that can cause a resonance with the building, and that is where the trouble will begin. So if you have buildings which have this wavy action, which have the resonance with the ground when the earthquake shaking happens, then of course we are in trouble. But in all cases, the earthquake is feeding energy to the building, and it is the responsibility, this is the amount of energy that is being fed to the building. It's the responsibility of the building to absorb this energy. If the building doesn't absorb this energy, it will continue to shake. Now, it can absorb it in two ways. One is through viscous damping, which is there inherently in a structure, which is because of the joints between the windows and the walls, or the doors and the walls, the micro cracking that is happening in the beams, and the wind resistance around it, and also the non-structural elements that we have added, adding a large amount of sliding surfaces and thereby dissipating energy. That is viscous damping, modeled as viscous damping. But what is crucial is the hysteretic energy, which means damage-based energy. That means you allow damage at the plastic hinges, desirable locations, and absorb the energy through that. A large amount of energy needs to be absorbed through hysteretic energy. Viscous energy is relatively very small. And therefore, this is the important part. Now, when you design a structure and shake it back and forth, you would get two options. One is on the left-hand side and one is on the right-hand side. As you can clearly see, the area, the orange area on the left-hand side is very small compared to the green area on the right-hand side. And so we have a large amount of energy absorption on the right-hand side structure. That is a good structure with a desirable collapse mechanism. The left-hand side is not a desirable collapse mechanism. It's a poorly designed structure with small size columns and so on. So there is strength and stiffness degradation on the left-hand side, while there is no stiffness degradation, but there's no strength deterioration and there is no stiffness degradation. On the left hand side, both strength degradation and stiffness deterioration are happening, right? Many a time you see in research studies that beam column joints tend to demonstrate large amount of hysteretic energy, especially in steel structures. But do not get mistaken that you cannot induce damage in the beam column joint because it has a bigger responsibility. So this option is not something that we will be able to accept, even though the beam column joints have large amount of energy dissipation capacity. So that's called the energy-based design. And we hope that in time ahead, both deformation-based design much earlier, but energy-based design also will come into picture. With that, you'll be able to design a structure to resist earthquakes of different severity, providing different energy or inducing different energy or imposing different energy on the buildings. So in effect, what we noticed is seven virtues are there, not four virtues. The four virtues that we started with were good seismic structural configuration, reasonable initial lateral stiffness, at least a minimum lateral strength. These were understood in the yesteryears, but in the recent times, good structural lateral displacement ductility, desired lateral collapse mechanism, required lateral deformability, and guaranteed energy dissipation capacity. These are the ones that are under research. And all of us need to believe that earthquake induces a force and it is not a force applied by the earthquake. There is nobody during earthquake, God is not standing and applying those red arrows on the buildings. No, he is not doing that. Induced, that means Newton's law is coming into picture. If you have relative movement at the base, because of the inertial effects, these forces are induced. And this is a mathematical way of representing the equivalent static forces on the structure. So earthquake resistant designs, stiffness based design, we don't talk about. Strength based design, deformation based design, and energy based design. Forced, we have gone in strength based design and we learned capacity design there. But in deformation based design, which is currently under development, both collapse mechanism and deformability are getting added. And in energy-based design, we have collapse mechanism, deformability, and energy absorbed. All of them are getting added here. So that is where the game will be, that once you're able to come up with a delta max, you can quantify ductility. And so right now, ductility is only a qualitative measure in capacity design, the way we are doing it right now. But in time ahead, we hope that we'll be able to bring it in totality. So the force-based design method will be mandatory for normal buildings in low seismic regions. Capacity-based design mandatory for normal buildings in moderate and high seismic regions. And both deformation-based design, energy-based design are going to be mandatory for all critical and lifeline buildings. And it is optional for normal buildings in high seismic regions. And so this is the roadmap that we are going to get into in time ahead. So as I said, we started with four virtues, but now we landed up with seven virtues. And you can see all the seven virtues: configuration, stiffness, strength, ductility, deformability, desirable collapse mechanism, and energy. So it's 5, 6, 7 that is the big ticket items here. And I hope that you will be able to concentrate at least in one of them and make a career out of that, right? As far as the future is concerned, very clearly, if you want to make buildings and structures safe against earthquakes, one of the key quantities that we need to estimate carefully is earthquake demand. It's the severity of the earthquake. It can be estimated by deterministic methods or by probabilistic methods. And that is what we're seeing, that if you look at it in the past, these are the peak ground accelerations that were taken for the purposes of design by the various design codes in the Asia Pacific region that you're seeing here. Interestingly, all of them are having a PGA, peak ground acceleration value of 0.36 G, 0.4 G, rather moderate and underestimated value. But if you look at New Zealand and if you look at Japan, they don't want to underestimate, they don't want to hide the number. And this is the big difference between developed or countries with advanced earthquake safety provisions and those countries which are still grappling with the issue or the excitement of keeping the costs of the structures very low. So cheap structures, that is the focus of most of these countries which are in red bars, and safe structures is the focus of the countries which are looking at the yellow bars there. So if you look at the response reduction factor, it's a wrong comparison. Most of the countries have a scale of 10, but India has a scale of 5. So this will not give you a good comparison. What will give you a good comparison is how much of the fraction of the weight are we designing for? And that is the AH value. And that's the middle column that you're seeing. Greece designs buildings and buildings for a coefficient of 26% of the weight. Turkey, Iran, they design for 13-14%. Pakistan designs for 19%. India designs for 9%. Nepal is following us, so they are also stuck with us with 9%. Indonesia goes to 19%, Philippines 11%, Australia 15%, Japan 30%, and New Zealand 25%. Look at the big jump in these two countries, in Japan and New Zealand. And of course, Greece, they have learned hard lessons. So they've also agreed that they want to make people safe and not just make cheap structures. So any country that wants to make buildings safe, they have to now climb the seismic coefficient. And it means that you have to use your mind more carefully. With the same material, can you increase the safety even though force is larger? That is the game. So it is in reducing the mass, but not reducing the acceleration. You cannot hide or say incorrect acceleration values, but you have to state the correct acceleration values and make light buildings. Only then you will survive in earthquakes. Otherwise, telling any lies about AH value or the Z value is going to keep us in deep trouble throughout our lives, right? So what we notice, the current practice of India is the red line and the best of the world is the green line. Now, what are these? On the x-axis is intensity of shaking, and on the y-axis is the peak ground acceleration, right? In India, buildings are collapsing at a much earlier, lower level of acceleration than what the other countries' buildings are collapsing at, right? Take an example of magnitude 6. We are collapsing at a much earlier level in acceleration than what the other countries are doing. And that is what our trouble is, that we hope that we will correct our construction design, planning, design, construction, maintenance procedures, so that we can move the red line close to the green line, that we improve our best practices to match that of the international best practices. So, right? So it is not that the MSK scale is failing here. We are failing the MSK scale here in this country. For example, if you look at it, the peak ground acceleration in Koyna earthquake 1967 is estimated to be about 0.63 g, and in Killari earthquake is around 0.5 g, right? And these curves, the intensities noted were 8 and 8 plus in these two events. But what did we do? We put that in seismic zone 4 and said peak ground acceleration is 0.24 g. You can see about a third of what the real world is. And here we put it in seismic zone 3, again, a third of what the real world is. So we are underestimating the acceleration by a large margin, especially for the surprise events, which are going to be very large earthquakes. And so we are further taking that peak ground acceleration and reducing it by another factor. And so we are actually not realizing what we are doing. And that is our trouble. Now we need to spring out of this quickly. One important point that we have to remember is that for a given site, what is crucial is that there is a maximum credible earthquake. Let us say this site has a maximum PG of 0.8 G. But then we take chances and then we design a, we say, no, this is the probability we will allow. And so we take a chance. And for normal buildings, we will say that we will design for a smaller value of peak ground acceleration. And we call this maximum considered earthquake. And this is how we are taking chances. But remember, 95% of the people die in buildings only. So this is where we need to think whether we are doing justice to the cause of the safety of the people by choosing a very small P ground acceleration than what is actually expected to come in that region. But you'll say, no, no, that's the international philosophy. Well, international philosophy doesn't come by the number of PGI alone. It comes by the fact that there is a strong techno-legal regime, there is a good technical education, and there is licensing of engineers, and there is peer review of the professional design submitted, and there is a random audit of all the activities that is being done. So then with all that happening, international best practices will say, we can take chances, but we will take lesser and lesser chances as the structures become more and more important for us, right? Hospitals are more important than normal buildings, so we call them important, and so we'll design for higher values. Critical structures like transport, water, power, communication, gas, industry related, business continuity related, we will design even for a higher value. And of course, dams and nuclear power plants, we will not tell lies. We will use the full value as it is. Now this, all this is subject to a nation having good pair of technical hands, not one or two in number, but in tens of thousands of wonderful structural designers and great peer reviewers and an exceptionally large list of licensed structural engineers and construction engineers in the country. So long as that is not there, we cannot copy the international practice blindly. And if we copy it blindly, the earthquake rest and design philosophy will not be valid or upheld by us in this country. And that is why only nuclear industry goes through a very, very rigorous process of peer review, and they take years to design one plant. Unlike in the rest of the structures where there is a great hurry to design it today and start construction tomorrow, right? So when you look at normal buildings, minor, moderate, severe shaking that we have, that will be the kind of behavior that we will see. And that will be the design force that we are going to use. But we call these by different names. But if you look at important buildings, we will reduce the nonlinear behavior and make it more and more linear behavior. As you can see, the structure is relatively more linear than the previous structure. And if you look at very critical buildings, the linear range is further enhanced, and only a little bit of nonlinearity, if at all, is allowed in those structures. And that is what is the changed expectation for different levels of structures. And hence, if you put all of the three together, you are getting this. For normal buildings, you'll allow damage, severe structural damage. For important buildings, only moderate. And for critical buildings, only minimum structural damage. And this approach, we can take the levels of damage, we can admit different levels of damage only if you are able to come up with a clear definition of what is minor, moderate, and severe earthquake. So there are different force, design force levels for the different earthquakes, for the different structures, and that is what we recognize in this process. And the design service level forces that are there are going to be about the same, but of course they will be very small compared to the design level shaking, and they will be the ones that we will use in the design. What you notice is the integrity level deformations, the maximum deformation imposed or achieved in these structures will be about the same, and that is why we are saying that deformability is the one that will save your structure and not the strength. So if you look at it, if you want to resist the same earthquake by nonlinear damage, you can. By linear structure, yes, you can. Both you can. So the game is, in the top structure you will make a expensive one, in the bottom structure you'll make a relatively lower cost structure. And this is the decision that we have to take at a country level and decide what is our priority, life or property or both, right? In the top it is both, in the bottom we are saying that we want to save lives and not the property. So we might have property loss. But if you have poor designers, poor constructors, and no techno-legal regime, the bottom structures are likely to collapse. As a consequence, the new concept of a return period comes into picture. It's not new for the world of professionals, but new for India in the design codes. It is being introduced. And you will see that for different structures, we will come up with different return periods. And also we will use the 95 percentile, if not 50 percentile. The discussion is still underway. So the design, how do we do that? We design for the middle one. All the design criteria, the strength criteria will be checked there. And then we will check for the lower level minor earthquake, the serviceability, whether stiffness, deflection, stresses, crack width, vibrations are getting satisfied at the lower level. And at the higher level, we'll make sure that no collapse is happening. So we design for the middle one and we will check serviceability for the lower earthquake and integrity for the higher earthquake. This way we will get a unique structure and only one design and the rest are all checks, right? So we'll, since we're going into nonlinear action, limit state method, we will continue there, but we can use working stress method for serviceability check. And of course, nonlinear seismic analysis will be used for collapse, no collapse, which means that it is time for the nation to learn nonlinear seismic analysis, right? This is what is the picture as the as it is emerging. This is one of the recent pictures. On the left hand side is the current Indian standard. On the right hand side is the new standard. And we can see here that we are looking at the Himalayas being termed together as high seismic region along with Kutch and Andaman Nicobar. But rest of the country might look a little similar, but the Himalayas, the numbers have gone up for all of them, right? Earlier 0.36G was the largest, but now we will go much more than 0.36G in the high seismic regions. And in the lower seismic regions, we will keep 0.18G or lesser, and then 0.18G to 0.36G, 0.36G to 0.6G, and there is a D here, which is more than 0.6G, maybe 0.8G or so, right? So what does it mean when you design for different levels? So this is the cost of the structure. If you keep the initial cost very small, the impact will be very different. What is it? There'll be severe amount of damage if you reduce the cost, initial cost, and so you have to do large amount of retrofit. So if you look at it on the left hand side, you'll get minimal structural damage, so retrofit is lesser. On the right hand side, you'll get even structural collapse, and hence you're seeing retrofit costs are very high, and in fact may not be possible to retrofit. And then the middle is where there is a no collapse story. So this is what we are saying, that all of us are watching only the cost, but what we have to watch is the impact. Look at this case, the total cost, which is original cost plus retrofit cost, is going to a minimum in the middle. And for the same horizontal line, which means the same cost, we are getting two structures. On the left, we are getting a structure which will have minimal structural damage. On the right, we have a structure which will have collapse. So for the same cost, why are we choosing the collapse option? And that is where the game is, that we're going to have loss of life on this side, but no loss of life on this side. It is time to change from the right side to the left side, because left side has the heart. And so I hope that we'll all behave human and have a heart and go to the left rather than go to the right, as far as saving people of India is concerned. The probabilistic seismic hazard inputs are potential events that are likely to happen, faults, rock properties, soil layers, and so on. So based on that, we do analysis of different years of return period and then come up with numbers. So what you're noticing is that the peak ground acceleration values will vary in, along the Himalayas from 0.7G to 1.5G. And that is what is the magic. And in the peninsular India, 0.5G to 1.2G. Those are the numbers that are coming out. Whether they'll ultimately be accepted in the standard is what we have to see. Alongside, there is another important aspect that we have to understand, and that is the movement near the faults, right? That was the point that we saw, that the plate was to move forward. It cannot go forward. It goes out and comes in again. So if you look at it in the fault parallel direction, you will notice that the structure, the ground is having a relative slip in the direction. So the red line is the fault line and the two plates that you are seeing alongside on either side of the fault. But if you look at it in the fault normal direction, that plate goes the same way But now if you look at the movement perpendicular to the direction of movement of the fault, then you will notice that it has an opening and closing kind of an action. So in the fault parallel direction, there is a jump. In the fault normal direction, there is a quick return back. But in all cases, one thing that was observed is that the ground velocity close to the fault is very large. In fact, with time, the peak ground velocity, larger and larger values have been recorded. Now almost 2 meters per second, 200 centimeters per second has been recorded. This is a slightly older picture. This doesn't mean that Earth is getting ferocious with time. No. Earlier, the number of instruments placed on the Earth were very small, very few. And now the number is large. And so we are getting closer and closer to the fault and keeping many instruments on the fault. So we're getting peak values. So the peak ground acceleration also, we have gone up to 3.2 G now, while the yesteryears, the normal understanding was it will be less than a G. But that was not true. With time, we are able to record more. So what we notice is near the fault, there are sharp pulses in the fault normal and fault parallel directions that are getting mobilized. So in the far field, you'll get a regular accelerogram. In the near field, you'll get a big jump there. You will see some sharp pulses. So that's how you will see here. And if you notice, the velocities are like 100 centimeter per second, right? Very large velocities. Look at it carefully. 100 centimeter per second velocity. Accelerogram doesn't tell you too much because you can't see much in that very high frequency activity. But as you come to velocity and displacement, you will see it's 80 centimeters of displacement. Right? Imagine putting a one-story building and it will go by 2.5 feet back and forth. That's a tough situation to be in near the fault. Right? What we noticed is in the far field, we get more high frequency, and in the near field, you'll get more low frequency, which means large natural periods. And that is where the game is, that this residual slip that is happening, the P ground residual displacement, or in a general case, so that's a strike slip, and this is a general oblique fault case. There'll be both horizontal as well as vertical movement that is happening, is going to cause large pulses. And these pulses result in very, very strong action on the buildings and structures. So the peak ground displacement, peak ground residual displacements are different, and they're going to be significant. And we need to recognize that in the calculations, in the design of buildings and structures in the near fault region. And these pulses, if you see, as you go farther away from the earthquake, this is 2001 Gujarat earthquake. If you see farther away, as you go farther away from the earthquake, those pulses vanish, right? And that is what we are saying, that in the near field only, you will see that. You won't see this in the far field. And in the east-west, north-south direction, especially if it is like a strike slip and if it is a thrust faulting, you'll also see some in the vertical direction. So one of our colleagues did a finite element analysis of the earth and did this study and said, from the fault line, how near is near field? That is the question that he was answering. But as he observed, the smear comes down around 200 kilometers. So if you are in Himalayas up to New Delhi, you will be able to see that severity of that. And that is the point that we're saying, that if you have large faults up to 200 kilometers, you can have the effect of it felt. And that's again shown in the displacement diagram. Also, the previous one was the PGDs, and here are the PGRD, residual displacements. That means after about 200 kilometers, you don't see any residual displacements. You'd see very less of it, but you'll definitely see in the near field in the first 100 kilometers, of course, there's a lot of action there. So it's not that it's the first 10 meters or 20 meters, it's hundreds of kilometers. 100 kilometers, that severity can be felt, right? This is the Indian plate tectonics. As you can see, the smooth part at the junction between Eurasian plate, Indian plate, is the Indo-Gangetic plane, Indus and Ganges. And all this is sandy. And if you have an earthquake shaking and the river is flowing full speed, then you will have liquefaction also. And so we are putting about 40% of India's, 35 to 40% of India's population on this Indo-Gangetic plain, which is pretty large population. And India is blessed with a large number of faults all over across the country. You can run but cannot hide from the faults. That is what is the story. And if you have not estimated the displacements, then the bridges that we have built can slip over their supports, piers, and fall down. The dams that we have built can be run through by the fault. And the pipelines that we are designing, building, can also be ruptured by that. But what still worries me is that pipelines, bridges, dams are far away. Cycle sheds, if we can fix in this 1 year, 2021 corona year, if we can fix our cycle sheds, I think we will do great service to the nation, right? Earthquake hazard assessment, we need to understand the physics of it, and especially we need to look at the displacement hazard as an important one. And I'm taking you closer to the large sediments that are there in the Indo-Gangetic plain, and that's the sediment that I'm talking about. And if you look at it, the ground itself has a natural period of 0.5 to 7 seconds, the Indo-Gangetic plain. So if you have structures whose natural periods match with that of the ground, then we are in trouble. As you can see, different structures will have different natural periods. But if the site period matches with that, we are going to be in great trouble. And should there be a big earthquake in the Himalayas, most of our structures can be put to test, and we can have a embarrassing moment for ourselves. This is what I want to sort of forewarn all of us in this discussion today. So when we look at minor, moderate, severe earthquakes, the key point is displacement demand. And so the question that you will ask today is that I have design displacement. How do I get maximum displacement? Typically, if you are looking at a design displacement, the maximum displacement is alpha times the design displacement. And alpha will be about a value of 10 if you're using a reduction factor of 5, 8 if you're using a reduction factor of 4, 6 if you're using a reduction factor of 3, and so on. Right? So this is where we are saying that you will be able to estimate the maximum demand that will come on the structure based on the design demand. So delta max you can estimate depending on what R factor you have used, and then make sure that by pushover analysis that you'll be able to get this curve and show that it has the required deformability. So in displacement based design, currently on the left hand side you see delta max and VB are the inputs for design. In displacement based design, delta max and VB will be there, but we are looking at a performance expectation. We are also going to give a capital delta max, not small delta max, but capital delta max. That means overall deformability also will give instead of just drift. So right now stiffness and strength are discussed. In displacement based design, the deformability also will be discussed, and the capacity to deform has to be examined in light of that. In energy based design, we will have not only strength, stiffness, and deformability, but also total energy coming into picture in time ahead. So what you notice is that when you have energy delta max and E minimum given to us, or the KI given to us, then you will notice that VB may not show up. VB will be calculated indirectly once energy and delta max and the ductility are given to us. Right, so a new method of design is required because we want to protect our structures from collapsing. So typical design process is where you apply the design code, do the design, and then you put synthetic ground motions, analyze them. But when the real earthquake comes, that's the true test, and that is the behavior that we want to ensure. If you can do it with synthetic motions itself, you can capture the behavior well and good. That is what we want you to do. So you need to improve your analytical tools and skills to be able to reach there. That is for new structures. But if you want to look at existing structures, you already have a structure, you do a synthetic ground motions, you apply them, or recorded ground motions, and then analyze the structure. If you look at the behavior not acceptable, then you do retrofit, and then you come up with a design. And then now the real test, the earthquake will come and give you the behavior. Right? But while you're doing retrofit itself, if you are able to put in the correct elements of retrofit, I pray that you will do the correct things in time ahead. But what is the importance of all of this to do safety assessment? The importance of all of this is risk assessment. And risk has three elements: hazard, vulnerability, and exposure. Hazard comes from earthquake science, vulnerability comes from earthquake engineering, and exposure comes from bylaws. All the three together will mean risk for us. But if you don't have the demand in control, and if you don't have capacity in control, then we are in trouble, actually. And so we hope that you will join this mission of improving the standards and improving the implementation of standards. And in 2016, we came up with the revised versions. But in 22, we will expect that we will come up with the new versions of the revisions of the standards. And also by 2000, and that should be deformation based. And in 2025, we hope we can bring some energy-based design into picture. Currently, there are 2,000 codes for buildings. 400 of them are related to safety, and only 10 of them are related to earthquake safety. So we have very few standards, and they are also insufficient. I'll explain that in a minute, right? When you look at new standards for assessment is what we require, because a large number of buildings are old, and we need to do quantitative assessment. Not qualitative, but quantitative. And that is why we need standards for assessment and also for non-structural elements. Now, assessment, if you're talking about, you can do assessment at four levels. One is rapid visual screening. Second is conceptual visual survey. Third is simplified quantitative assessment. Fourth is detailed quantitative assessment. The first one is useful only if you want to say, prima facie, I have 1 lakh buildings. I won't be able to retrofit all of them. How do I screen them? And that is why this is done only for screening, but not to determine safety. Please do not mistake the rapid visual screening to be determining safety. No, it is about screening the number from 1 lakh to a smaller number. Second one, when you get a 1 lakh is to go to 10,000, you get a conceptual visual survey done, and the 10,000 will bring it down to 1,000, saying that 1,000 need to be considered for retrofitting. Then we do simplified quantitative assessment, which is basically equilibrium or safety in the X and Y directions, so the shear resistance of the building. Then we're looking at overall safety margin, X, Y, and Z direction. And we will be able to bring that 1,000 down to 100. And those 100 will be subjected to the detailed quantitative assessment, and we'll identify building level as component level deficiencies. And so we have these four levels: rapid qualitative, detailed qualitative, simplified quantitative, and detailed quantitative. And what we should begin our work with is the simplified quantitative, and not one and two, because one and two is only for screening. The engineers come into picture at 3 and 4. Engineers will do hard work, do studies, and give them the forms for screening at levels 1 and 2. And the younger engineers should be able to implement that under the supervision of an experienced engineer. And but the design effort or the calculation effort will come at 3 and 4. As I said, scaling down from 1 lakh to 10,000 to 1,000 to 100 is the game. And that is why you do screening by the lower methods. And the time taken for the retrofit design is much larger. The rigor is much larger. And hence, you will notice that 100 buildings, unless you have enough number of hands, you can't do it in a year. But we don't have people to do 100 buildings retrofit by the formal procedure, even based on the available international procedure. We don't have people. And that's the summary of today's a status of the professional hands that we have. Earthquake resistant constructions, if you are looking at it, you need to do estimation of the hazard and design in detail and assess and retrofit. So if you're doing a new structure, you need the first two. If you have the old existing structures, you fix that, you need all the three of them. So in time ahead, what we are hoping is 1893, 13920, 15988, those will be the numbers. But then we will develop parts, and parts will be parallel. For example, if you are looking at buildings, buildings in 1893, buildings in 1390, buildings in 15988. Even within buildings, we have concrete buildings, steel concrete composite, masonry, adobe, timber. Those are also going to be available for 13920 and 15988. The green boxes are the ones where we have the standard, orange is where we have a draft, and white is where nothing has happened so far, right? This page is very exciting because a lot of work has been done. But if you go down here, bridges and industrial structures, we only have 1893 and 13920 part. We don't have 15988, and for dams and embankments also we don't have a standard for that. Liquid retaining structures, we have 1893, 13920, 15988 is under preparation. Retaining walls, 1893 only, not 13920, 15988. Base isolated structures and pipelines, this is a new one. We have 1893, 13920 coming up, and then the pipeline standard is also coming up in that. Right? We're looking at tunnels, coastal structures, steel towers, yet to do something on that. We have additional provisions. For example, earthquake hazard assessment, as I said, we are revising the hazard. It will go into the part one of 1893, 13920, 15988. Geotechnical aspects also we are trying to improve and revise. Foundations also improve and revise. Performance-based design is something that is being considered, right? For retrofit only, but not for new structure design. We have come up with a draft for seismic protection of architectural elements and utilities. And for the others, work is underway for equipment and piping, testing of structures, energy dissipation devices, post-earthquake damage assessment of buildings, and earthquake microzonation. These are the other standards that are under consideration, and draft we have already for one of them. There's a standard related to tsunamis, and there's another one for seismic instrumentation of river valley projects. These are under development. The blast resistant design structure standard is very old, and we are coming up with a new one now, and so we hope that we can release this soon, right? What is also being appealed to all the members of the drafting groups is that for all new standards, we'll come up with commentaries of the codes so that the revisions of the standards will get easier in future. Also, if you are revising an existing standard, we also want to develop a commentary for that. It's a national need, and we don't have partners. So if anybody wants to be part of this process of writing commentaries, I think you have a great exciting opportunity today, right? In time ahead, we are hoping that 1893, 13920 will get comprehensively revised. We will harmonize parts 2, 3, and 4 with the rest of the codes. We are also looking at the blast resistant design codes to come in and get updated. And we are reconsidering the 4326, 13826, 827 to become part of 1893 part 6 and 7. Confined masonry, we are releasing one soon. Draft is already ready. Steel structures, draft is ready. Buried and overground pipeline, draft is ready. Architectural elements and utilities, draft is ready. Assessment and retrofit for reinforced masonry, this is already published in NBC. That also will be put as a separate standard. So that's where we stand. A lot of exciting action this year. At least 6 codes will come into picture if we are able to come out of this pandemic. Right. One of the important codes that will come is the base isolation of buildings, especially for hospitals and critical structures. We are hoping that the standard will come in handy for the design and development of such activities. So I'll stop here by sharing a few thoughts. Classical earthquake resistant design philosophy says that there are 3 levels of earthquake shaking intensities, and that no collapse is the focus for us. And we also realize that it's in the hands of the designer to decide whether we can design a building with damage or without damage, but it can happen only with the concurrence of the client owner, because the costs have to be accommodated accordingly. But the truth is, teachers today still consider earthquake to be an oscillation, it is as a force on the building and not as an oscillation. So they need to consider earthquake to be movement under the structure. And they need to teach nonlinear analysis as part of the master's curriculum, and they need to teach basic earthquake design as part of the bachelor's curriculum, both of them mandatory curriculum. If it is elective, it is not a curriculum. Elective is a, you know, time wasting effort, because not many people will take it, and so it doesn't make any difference to the nation. And professionals and teachers, they need to participate in revising the standards regularly. 1990s, we spent our time on automation, 2000s on quality, 2010s on innovation. All those exciting words are over now. There's only one exciting word that was there all through, never given attention. I pray that in this decade, we will climb safety to higher levels. But it can happen only if the global populace of our students, faculty members, and professional engineers come together and make it happen. The decadal excitement was the past story. I don't want safety to be a decadal excitement. I want it to be a long-term focus, and only then this nation will be a sustainable, will do sustainable development. Otherwise, we will not do sustainable development, right? I learned one thing, that 100 is the enemy of 80. That is, best is the enemy of good. So we should get started with the good, and the best will happen over time. So instead of waiting for the ideal, clean, everything is beautiful picture, you can start selling your early pictures of your painting that you do, and then make a living. And eventually you might make a very good picture, which will be sold at a handsome price. That is the way life is. And we have to climb slowly on a ramp rather than put ladders on. Right? And if we have to improve in this country, we have to stop being spectators and start being players. And this is a habit that we have to change. And talking about change, there'll be only small things that you are required to change, not big things. And I hope that you will do that small thing and not be lazy, as in this picture shown, where you say it's not my job to remove the twig, because that's the forest department's work. And the PWD doesn't remove the forest department's trees that have fallen down. But whether you do it or not, whether you do your exercise of hazard assessment or not, the earthquake is not going to pardon us, right? It will run through wherever it has to. So if you don't do your homework properly, you will be embarrassed like in here. And that is where I think we need to be a little more humble. And I know that nature is difficult to predict, but nature we can estimate based on past experiences, and use that estimated value for design. If you don't even estimate, then there is no beginning also, right? Earthquake disaster mitigation is a long road, and there are so many things to be done in this earthquake disaster mitigation, especially the left three items: documenting typologies, manuals of good practice, technical education. Is the professional engineer academia's business. And the second two columns, safety and practice, outlawing unsafe typologies, developing new technologies, full-scale testing, developing skills, continuing education, undertaking retrofit, and developing standards, is that of the professional engineers with the engagement of teachers. And then the last one is largely governments, where changing of bylaws, licensing of engineers, peer review, risk indexing, structural safety, all this is Structural Safety Act. All this is part of the government. So academia, industry, and government, all three have to come together to make this nation a safe nation. But if you look at it, the first two are knowledge related, next two are skill related, and third is attitude related. And only if knowledge, skill, and attitude are together that we will be able to make a competent nation. And that is what I want to say, that even though I'm focusing this lecture on development of standards, there is so much more we need to do to make this nation competent, right? Of all of these, positive attitude, skills, and knowledge, undoubtedly the winner is positive attitude. If you have positive attitude, you can develop skills and knowledge over time. But if you have no positive attitude, if you have negative attitude, you, even if you have skills and knowledge, you can be a dangerous person. And hence, I pray to all the audience today to consider developing positive attitude carefully, closely, consistently over time in the years to come. Right? I will say structural safety is a pointed question. Answers have to be pointed and precise, and lives are at stake. The Constitution of India requires every citizen to be responsible for safety of other citizens also, and hence we are bound to give safety to the other people as civil engineers, right? From untruth to truth, from darkness to light, and from life to eternity, I pray that these lessons will not be forgotten by all of us, and that we will make useful contributions in our life. I thank Professor Kumuda for the opportunity to share some thoughts today. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time and attention. Jai Hind. If you have any questions, I can take them at this point of time.
Yes, Professor, thank you very much for your informative session and also wonderful message shared to us. And I hope we can see the questions in the chat box.
Okay, I'm opening the chat box here. How can we give small projects to students based on upcoming parts of the code, especially steel structures? So there is a group that is working on development of seismic design of steel buildings and structures. So what I would urge is that the convener of that group is Professor Rupen Goswami of IIT Madras. So you could engage with him and see if you can do small problems which they need to verify before the code is released. Also, sometimes they will require people to do a large number of buildings to be analyzed by the new clauses and make sure that it is equally valid for all the buildings. And so that is what I would recommend, that it should be that if you want to do some work, please let us know. We will put you in touch with the corresponding convener, and you will be able to sort of do small little works with them. How can practicing engineers take part in the code commentary work? Practicing engineers will have to give 5% of their time in designing. See, what happens is Bureau of Indian Standards will send you a draft of the document before it is published or made a code. At the draft stage itself, you have to spend 5% of your time in trying to come up with a you design a building. They'll also give you a template building. You design that building and show that process is valid, and that there are no challenges that are happening in the development of this in the use of this new standard. And professional engineers have a center space in that. Second, professional engineers need to comment on the existing document. Many a time you go through challenges, but you don't share your challenges. So you should share your challenges with the code committee, which is Bureau of Indian Standards. And you should be conscious that you will learn only if you share, because only when the questions are raised will the answers come. Somebody is saying, how confined masonry, unconfined masonry respond to earthquakes? Unconfined masonry will collapse, confined masonry will not collapse. As straightforward, as blunt as that, I have talked at the beginning of the lecture that you will see that the dynasties have collapsed because they made only masonry structures, unreinforced masonry structures. So confined masonry is the only way to save. You can't say stop doing masonry structures. No. Help people who are doing masonry structures, because masonry is still the more economical material. Help people make them safer. And so that is the story of confined masonry. We will not allow unconfined masonry anymore as part of seismic safety. PEB code, pre-engineered buildings, we will not want to have a code right now. What we want to have is that we want people to do testing, full-scale testing of the pre-engineered buildings, right? If you do line welds, tack welds, and you want to make buildings out of that, don't kill other people. Right, that is not normal steel sections. Them steel members sections themselves are not able to make buildings safe, and you will make these economical 8 mm bars bent as shear connectors between some angles at the top and the bottom is not the way. if you are looking at PEB, please do full scale testing before you even think of doing the code. Any company which has done PEB testing full scale only should be able to talk about developing a standard. In mega projects in India, consulting firms are always from abroad. Why is it so? Because all of us are smoking BDs. We are not developing our competence, and so they will only take the cake. Knowledge is the power. If you don't have knowledge, you will not have the power. And how do we exactly account ductility in response reduction factor? Right. So this is a very classical study, and response reduction factor has two parts in that. In fact, three parts. One is called the ductility reduction factor. One is overstrength factor. And the third one is redundancy. And I am hoping that you will read some international literature and get comfortable with that. Mansur Desab. Gaurav Verma says, how the cost of construction for buildings would be affected as the new codes increase ZPA values, especially new near Himalayas. So I am not worried about the cost of the code, cost of the construction at this point of time. I'm worried about saving people's lives. Now, if you continue to talk about cost of the structures, you will never ever come out of that fix, because the cheapest is the only acceptable answer for you. Even if you spend 1 rupee more, you will be in trouble. Now, Gaurav Verma sahab, I would like to say one thing to you. If you look at the cost of a building project, the cost of the structure is 100 rupees, cost of the land is 1000 rupees. Out of the cost of the structure of 100 rupees, 80 rupees is non-structural elements and 20 rupees is structural elements. In 20 rupees, if I ask 20% increase, that is 4 rupees increase. In a total cost of 1100 rupees, I'm asking 4 rupees increase, which is 0.04% or 0.4% of increase. If you're unhappy with 0.4% of increase, I would say then I don't want to discuss anything with you, because it is this 0.4% that will save the entire 1100 rupees. That 4 rupees will save the whole 1100 rupees. So wisdom is very important at this point of time. Instead of getting stuck on low cost, I think low cost will have meaning only if it is guaranteed with safety. Any statistics addressing cost compared with gravity design? Well, this is what all the small projects question was there. No, do a design for gravity loads only and do a design for lateral loads only. But remember, if you use moment frames and say I will do lateral load design, that is the worst answer. You have to change the structural system once you come to lateral loads to structural walls. Only then economy can be brought in. Otherwise, economy cannot come into picture. So blindly using the same structural system for low seismic to high seismic is not the solution. You also have to evolve by choosing better and better structural systems, because in high seismic regions, we want good structural behavior. We don't want poor structural behavior. ETABS has 1893-2006. Yes, PEB doing few lab tests in general in Jamshedpur. I hope that they are full-scale tests, not member tests and component tests and material tests. Full-scale tests. I don't know if Jamshedpur has a facility to have a three-story PEB building tested full-scale. And if it has, I'll be very happy to learn more about it. If it doesn't, then I am in trouble, because you will say I have done testing. And I will say you have not done this test and you have not given me this behavior. So it will be unnecessary discussion. So please check with your Jamshedpur story whether it has full scale testing or they're doing component testing. I don't want component tests. All components will survive, but we don't know the meaning of components. Connections is the problem. And components are rated only for certain load levels, not for high load levels. When you put them as part of a big system, they may be required to take higher load. And that is where the trouble begins. Seismic isolation by friction pendulum isolators in residential buildings feasible and economical for India? You want the final answer, Ahmed Saab? Well, I don't know if I can answer your question, but I can say that it is possible to design buildings by using friction pendulums for this country. That's the first statement. Second statement, most cases isolators are expensive and so the cost will be higher. But if you go by my previous friend, if you're worried about cost, then it's not possible. The day you put life ahead, you will increase cost. And then you say life and performance ahead, you will increase cost further. So when you're saying seismic isolation by friction pendulum isolators in residential buildings, you're asking for the second level. One for safety of the people and second for the performance also. So if you are asking two levels, then you have to spend two levels higher. So I don't know the word economical. One man's meat is another's poison. It may be economical for one, but not for the other. So we have to target it for a certain audience. I don't know how to do that. Maybe you know better. Ahmed Sahab. When performance-based design code is coming in India, it is not coming as code. It will come as clauses. It will come as clauses for existing structures. So 15988, where it is assessment and strengthening of existing buildings, in that particular vertical, you will be able to see that you will have some clauses being brought in to assess. You saw the closed loop system I talked about, the forward loop for design and the reverse loop for assessment. That closed loop system is what is going to be the focus in that. Okay. For low cost housing, if we use mud block as infill, is the structure become safe against earthquake? Infill you said, but what is the structural system which is carrying the load? If you answer that, then I can answer this. It is good to do retrofitting of old buildings, but at present, even in big cities, a lot of small buildings are not designed for earthquake. As long as there is no strict enforcement of code provisions from government and design of buildings, even new buildings are safe for earthquakes. Chandra Saab is feeling very bad. Chandra Saab, no point in feeling bad. Please prepare retrofit technologies, solutions. Keep it ready. The day government is ready, we will give them the answers. Do licensing of engineers in the meantime. If licensing is not happening, do mock exams for licensing if you're a faculty member. If you're a professional engineer, then do spend some time in the professional societies and encourage people to do licensing. What is the importance of steel concrete composite structures in earthquake resistance? Importance? No, that's not what we're saying. We are saying that professional practice is already using it. And we don't want to allow them to use without any regulation. They are applying the concrete code provisions, the steel code provisions, the hodgepodge. Instead of doing a hodgepodge, we'll give them a clear demarcated process, and that will help them do steel concrete composite structures with a lot more confidence. Can we do PSHA or DSHA for stable continental region? Sanghai Saab is asking. Well, if you do deterministic seismic hazard assessment, you need data. And we don't have sufficient data for the peninsular India. And that is the difficulty we are facing in the revision of the seismic hazard map. And so we are having to do a lot of debate and discussion. We are using probabilistic hazard seismic hazard assessment, but we are also doing deterministic and making sure that the probabilistic is not unduly low or unduly high from the deterministic hazard. Right? What is the best connection observed so far in earthquake resistance? Best connection is human connection. If people talk to each other, learn from each other, that is the best connection. Of course, Chandrika ji, I'm trying to cut a joke here, but I hope that you're talking about steel structures, or are you talking about concrete structures? Mrs. Chandrika, can you answer your question? I mean, clarify your question. Is it for composite structure? Yes. So for composite structures, you need to have tests done. If it is a steel column, concrete beam, we need to develop details for that. Right? If it's a concrete column, steel beam, we need to develop details for that. Detailed studies have not happened. And so that is where the laboratories across the country need to work together in a coherent manner to come up with a detailed testing program for this country. right? As of now, testing culture is slowly vanishing because testing is costing money and nobody is investing money. So it is time for us to find some good Samaritans who will understand the seriousness and importance of this. I hope most of them will come from industries. Okay. Rahul Shah is still upset about the classical question, why do boys have all the fun? Why architects get paid more than structural engineers? Rahul Shah Saab, if you do good quality work, you will also get paid. So only one watchword for us, quality, quality, quality. That's what Vidya Balan has taught us. So we will go with quality. You improve your quality and you will get paid enough, right? I'm not saying more. I don't know if we should get paid more or they should get paid more. All I should say is for the hard work you put in, are you getting paid enough? In upcoming seismic code, is there any clause for design of braces, buckling restraint braces? Yes, madam, there is. Yes, Vivek Pahuja sir, buckling restraint braces aayenge. Aayenge, but we'll see whether we can put it in this very version or the next version. Those are the questions as of now. Are there more thoughts? I am happy to chat up. There was one question I slipped deliberately, which I can take now. Is there somebody wanted PowerPoint presentation, right? And they want to do it in the classroom. But the trouble that you'll get with this PowerPoint presentation is it has only images. The sentences are not there. So which sentence will you make? That is the worry. So what is important is that you get the spirit behind today's lecture. Pick one item, do a detailed study, and then go ahead and give your original lecture. Because it is very difficult to give a lecture based on somebody else's PowerPoint slides. Chandrika ji is asking question. No problem, madam. Get the questions rolling. Don't worry about it. Which is the best analytical software? Madam, this is a tough question. You are getting me in the middle of all these companies. They will kill me. But all I'm saying is, let us have a competition between all these softwares and do a standard problem by all the software and see which one is doing better. What I understood in life is, some softwares are good at some structures, some other softwares are good at other structures. That is the first thing. Some softwares do static analysis nicely, some do dynamic analysis nicely. Some do linear analysis nicely, some do non-linear nicely, right? And some of them do good graphic user interface, some of them do poor graphic user. Some of them integrate the software, I mean the files from AutoCAD better, some of them do poor. So those are all the various factors. It will be, you know, if I have to live and take care of my parents, I should not answer that question today. Many of them are dangerous questions. I may be killed if I answer those questions. So ask more safer questions, madam. These are dangerous questions. Indian Railways will have different code for seismic analysis in future for bridges. Indian Railways already has a seismic code. And it is not too different from the IRC code. So no major surprises. Their loads are different, that's all. Otherwise, concepts can be very different. They are the same. So you can download this Indian Railway ka seismic code from the web also. Thakur sir, please download it from the web. What are the upcoming thrust areas in seismic analysis and design? Madam, Ramayana is over. Now you're asking who is Ram and how is he related to Sita? Nonlinear analysis. Nonlinear analysis is the game, right? If teachers of India don't learn nonlinear analysis, we can never do seismic retrofitting in this country or retrofitting of any of the existing buildings and structures in the country. It is time for us to do nonlinear seismic analysis, right? As far as design is concerned, I think you slept off on those slides where I talked about the future methods of design. Ahmed sahab wapas aa gaye hain. Fling step time histories and directivity effect, what is the difference? Which is more fatal? Are devil and the deep blue sea, both are important, right? But the fact is, in near fault conditions, you will have to incorporate both of them. Fling step is there, and depending on which earthquake, suppose I'm sitting in Uttarakhand and then the Nepal part of it fractures and comes and the wave comes towards Uttarakhand, or I'm sitting in Uttarakhand and an earthquake happens and is going towards Himachal and north, northwest. So obviously in one case the energy is directed towards Uttarakhand, another case energy is directed away from Uttarakhand. So that is the reason why I would say that recorded ground motions, which have been recorded in these different Himalayan sites or near fault sites, please examine those and study them carefully. Thakur sahab aa gaye. Thakur sahab, thank you so much for your affection. Sanjay sahab aa gaye hain. Is BIS providing sponsored projects? BIS doesn't provide sponsored projects to anybody and everybody. BIS is providing sponsored projects to code committee members for developing the standards. For developing the standards, they are enabling small monies. These are not crores of rupees. Kisi ko 5 lakh rupiah diya because they want to appoint one project associate and do some collation of literature, purchase some literature, study them and prepare basic drafts for the development of standards. So that is happening. But I don't know, they are talking about a new policy, R&D policy. They might pick it up. It is still on the anvil. I have not seen a final decision on that. I will tell you if there is something happening. For designing RC elements like normal portal frame manually against earthquake, what are the design factors to be followed? Anusha ji, ye, it is time for you to do formal analysis and design. You can do manually also and do a quick check. What are the design factors to be followed? All the design factors listed in the code have to be acceptable, have to be admitted and followed. There is no shortcut in that. Whether you do hand calculation based, manual or computer based, the story is the same. Bansodi sahab aa gaye, purane mitra. Multi-story structures have different frequencies. Same way, earthquake induces will also have many uncertain frequencies. So, for which earthquake frequency is the structure designed in order to avoid a structural collapse? So, Bansodi sahab, this story is one part of it is reflected in the design spectrum. Which frequencies are important, right? And the second part of it is whether resonance will happen. Design codes will say follow the spectrum and design for that. These frequencies are lesser forces, those frequencies are higher forces. That's part of the earthquake characterization. The second part is site. If you are sitting at a site which has got a thick alluvium and the earthquake is a very severe earthquake, it's going to swing back and forth like in Mexico City 1985, then you will have trouble. So site investigation. So site investigation, not 15 meters, 20 meters. If you go to Indo-Gangetic Plain, I showed you that picture. In Jabalpur, 0 kilometers. In Lucknow and Kanpur, 1 kilometer, half a kilometer. In Lucknow, 3 kilometers. You go to Foothill, Gorakhpur, 5 kilometers. So if that is the story, then you have to do formal geophysical investigations to obtain the sediment thickness. Right? For a three-story building in zone 2 built without seismic codes, will it withstand without much damage for earthquake or small magnitudes? You think that I'm an astrologer or I'm a foreteller? I am not. With this kind of minimal information, if I start speaking, I will be, disrespecting my profession. So I would say, do the calculations and show. I've given you a hint, calculate delta max. As 2R times delta design and do pushover analysis and show that it is not exceeded. That is the game that you have to play, Priyusha. What Sanghai sahab aa gaye, what is the specified distance to near fault site? Abhi the debate is on. Some countries have 15, some countries have 50, and some countries have 70, 80 and so on. So various grades. We haven't concluded yet. We'll come up with some number. And that number might change over time as knowledge improves. Can you suggest any good research topics related to earthquake engineering for PhD in India? I think we should have chai. Chandra Saab, Naveen Chandra Saab, we should have chai. This is not a newspaper item, no sensational game. The supervisors of India and students of India have to sit down. It is the students' knowledge and skill and the supervisors' experience and wisdom coming together to come up with a research PhD topic. So it will be a negotiable item. It cannot be items stuck on the wall and we pick one of them. Having said that, you saw that we have so many standards to be built, and we need to develop a large number of standards. So virtually the field is green, open. It is open situation, right? And so I would say almost every subject is still open for PhD work right now. Even buildings, bridges. In fact, we don't have too many bridge engineers. So bridges will be an exciting area. Water tanks. We have people designing water tanks at a very small price over a weekend. We want you to do formal design, and you know, I would say for faculty members, do model designs for seismic zone 2, 3, 4, 5. Same structure, water tank, bridge, building, concrete building, steel building, masonry building. And come up with books of model codes or model designs along with some professional engineer you can work, faculty members and professional engineers. That will be a very good game to come up with. And in the process, the questions will come. As you implement the different standards, the questions will come. If you follow all design criteria as mentioned in the code, and even the structure collapses, then who can be said to be responsible for it? Is it the code or the structural designer, right? The best available knowledge is being put in the standard. If you read the terms of all contracts, you are, as a structural engineer, bound by the fact that have you complied with the standard? Have you made sure all the clauses of the code are satisfied? So that will be your responsibility, and I hope you will do that. Right, Amit Verma sir. Anusha is saying, how can we maintain good bond between infill and frame to avoid in-plane, out-of-plane failure? Anusha, one is made of concrete, other is made of masonry. One is made of steel, other is made of, you know, POP or something like that. You can never have a good joint. Whatever you try, they're different materials, modulus is different. So they will, temperature shrinkages will happen, and they will always see, be a line between them, right? If you ask architects, they'll cut a groove because the line will be, the crack will be forced in that line. So don't think that you will solve that problem of, only if it is the same material, then you will, you're likely to not have a, you know, joint. And then you will, of course, have monolithic. As far as out of plane, in plane are concerned, in plane, if you want no damage in the infill, see, the world is divided into two sets of people. One set of people says infills are bad, and one set of people say infills are good. Those who say infills are good are saying that my frame is so bad that my infill is saving me. This is like India, if you go all the way towards Iran and go to Greece, Italy, this side, along the Himalayas. And that is where we are saying that infills are good for us because our frames are not designed. But if you make such structures with open ground solid, trouble, collapse. So, and also in India and these countries, the room sizes are very small. 3 meters, 2 meters, 4 meters, and so on. But you go farther away to the west, their spans are 6 meters and 8 meters. Their infills will, you know, collapse out of plane. In India, the panel sizes are so small, they don't collapse out of plane. 230 brick wall, clear in a 3 meter will be 2.7. and clear in a 3 meter with the beam depth of 450 is 2.5. So you are not able to, you are not going to have any L by T's and H by T's are going to be satisfied in Indian condition. Other countries, they are not satisfying because story heights are 4.5 meters, spans are 8 meters. So those countries with large spans, they say infills are bad. Now in India, if you are going to have the infills as part of the lateral load resistance, then I would say that it has to be to carry the loads. And masonry, when it carries the load, it will crack. So in India, it has to be taken as fuse. The building is saved, the fuse is cracked, replace the fuse after the earthquake, put a new walls, a new set of walls, and then go forward, live happily ever after. That would be my suggestion for Anusha, right? There are details. You can keep gaps between the infill and the frame, design gaps. How much is the frame swinging? That much gap you keep and then fill it with something. And if that filler is very expensive, don't come back to me. Ramchandra Saab, how can we do seismic analysis for stone masonry structures? Sir, there is what is called discrete element method. So you have to learn discrete element method and do time history analysis of discrete element. Stone over stone, you shake them at the base, the stones will slide based on the friction between the stones, and that will be the method of analysis. This, you need to learn this and adopt that. Can we have more precise method than time integration nonlinear dynamic analysis for structures? Well, you can do something, Ahmed Saab. I'll be very happy to learn from you. As of now, this is the best nonlinear dynamic time history analysis. If there is a better one, please tell me. I will be happy to learn from you. How much more importance for moment resting frames in upcoming codes? Slowly, moment resting frames will be downplayed. Moment resting frames with structural walls will be played up. And for high seismic regions, you cannot build structures without structural walls. What is the impact of opening in confined masonry, and which location is best for opening in confined masonry? Okay, confined masonry is going to have false columns or false beams, which they call as practical columns and practical beams, around all openings. So they are the reinforcing elements along the openings. So in which case they are. For small room sizes that we have in India, they have given details for confined masonry, what will be the size of the reinforcing elements, horizontal and vertical reinforcing concrete elements around the openings. And I have not seen, there are some guidelines on what will be the sizes of the openings and so on. And as of now, symmetric is still the best position wise. Okay. Madam, our audience is found wanting. They don't have any questions. They have a lot of thank yous, and I also have immense affection and respect for all the colleagues who ask questions. And I pray that I have managed to give you an answer. And if there is more, please, send a note. Thank you so much, each of you. Yeah. Once again, grateful for the affection and grateful for your questions. And please continue to learn. Only through learning we will be able to share more.
Yes, Professor. So on behalf of SPC and the participants of this FDP program, so with a deep sense of appreciation, I'd like to convey my sincere thanks to Professor PVR Murthy for his enlightening lecture. So I can say this is the most interactive session today with a lot of questions by the participants to the resource person. So thank you, Professor, for answering all the questions raised by the participants. So thank you so much for your presence today. Yeah, we are very much fortunate to hear your lecture today. So thank you so much, Professor.
Extremely grateful, madam. Thank you once again to you and the entire set of colleagues in Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again for your time and attention. Thank you.